Yeah, I wasn't able to round up anyone for the library board, so thanks for, how's that going to work with the library board? Now we have all these people. How do we pick one?
We're on counselors. So the applications have been recirculated to you. So they should be at the top of your inbox there.
Okay. Good morning. I would like to call this meeting to order, the meeting of the Assiniboine Community Committee for November 25th, 1 month until Christmas. I would also like to acknowledge that we are on Treaty 1 territory, the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. I want to acknowledge and welcome my colleagues, Councillor Lukes and Councillor Gillingham, as well acknowledge our senior committee clerk, Ms. Cowan. We will be joined later by members of the public service. I know Mr. Jasper will be joining us. I believe Mr. Clark is scheduled to appear, but he's on our list, but he will not be appearing now. That concert's been canceled. We will not get to hear from Mr. Clark. And of course, I want to thank all the other members of the public service that are here today and welcome those of you watching on YouTube. Let's start the meeting first by having someone move a motion for the minutes from the October 30th meeting to be taken as read. Councillor Lukes, so move. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. Over to you, Madam Clerk.
First item is citizen member appointments for the Assiniboia Library Advisory Committee.
Right.
I believe the applications have been circulated to all of the councillors.
Yes, I'm just bringing you that we have the latest version arrived this morning. Is that correct? Okay. Just going to that right now. There was one new addition from what we had previously, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And that, could you identify that for me, or is that?
Typically, we don't list the applicants.
Right.
Just list the folks that are appointed to the committee.
Correct. Okay, I've got it now.
I'd be willing to make a motion on this. We have three, right?
We need three.
Three spaces?
Yeah.
There are three vacancies and there are four applicants.
Yes. Okay. So I can just move three names, right, out of the four for the record? Okay. I trust that I get the name pronunciation correct, so my apologies to those in advance. So. So I would move, Michelle Bell, Devin Bray, Maria Christina George be appointed to the citizen member appointments to the Assiniboia Library Advisory Committee. Now, Madam Clerk, is there a time frame on these appointments? Are they all for two-year appointments or are they?
Two-year appointments for terms to expire December 31st of 2022.
Okay. Excellent. All right. So moved.
All right. Any discussion? Great motion. I think it includes people from throughout the area, which is fantastic to see. So I'll call the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's carried. We'll move on to item two, which is results of the September 22nd, 2020 advertisement. Ms. Clerk, I'll turn it over to you.
So we have Tim Austin joining us via Zoom for this item.
Hi, good morning, councillors. Hopefully everybody's having a good morning.
Can't see you, Tim. We can't see you.
You can't see me. Oh, start my video. Sorry. There we go. How is that?
Perfect.
I don't like looking at myself on these things, so maybe that's why I keep the camera off. Good morning, everyone. This report highlights the advertising results of the proposed asphalt back lane local improvement in all lanes in the block bounded by Ness, Bruce, Ainsley, Rita, including the east-west lane of Sinawak Bay. This proposed local improvement was initiated in the spring of 2020 by council and therefore went directly to the advertising stage and did not need a petition at that for this local improvement. The proposed local improvement was advertised on September 22nd, in which the property owners have 30 days to object. In order to defeat the local improvement, property owners representing 60% of total accessible frontage must object to the improvement. Within the 30-day time frame, a notice of objection petition was issued and returned. The petition itself had signatures from property owners representing 83% of the total accessible frontage feet. Therefore, the proposed local improvement project has been defeated and cannot proceed. Because the local improvement was defeated at the advertising stage, a new project for a back lanes in this area cannot be requested for 2 years in accordance with the City of Winnipeg.
Councillor Gillingham has a question.
Sure. Yeah, thank you very much. Actually, more probably a couple of comments. Thank you, Mr. Austin, for your work on this. And this is the process that we do have in place. And this is the procedure that has been set up. And I know that there was certainly discussion with the area residents prior to the council decision. And it is evident and certainly well within their right that many individuals changed their mind between the council decision and the petition being circulated. And as I said, that is completely the process that we have, and it's certainly the right of the residents. So do appreciate the report that we have before us and the indication that for the next couple of years at least, no attempt can be made to institute a local improvement project on those lanes. So thank you for this, and certainly, obviously, I'll move acceptance of this report, concurrence in this report, unless one council colleagues have any comments or questions on it.
Councillor Loops?
Is this the one, Councillor Gillingham, that is beside, I want to say, the Lions Club or the Kinsman Club or something?
Yeah, there's three lanes, and they border on the St. James Kiwanis courts.
Right.
And then also on the St. James Metropolitan Kiwanis building on right on Ness. And so it's kind of an H set of back lanes. It looks like an H from an aerial view. I'll leave comment about the condition of the lanes for another day. But nonetheless, this is, as I said, this is the process. The residents have chosen, to not go forward with the local improvement, as is their right.
So before we vote, I'm just had a question about this, Mr. Austin. I noticed that these are the concrete back lanes, and I agree with Councillor Gillingham. The residents have spoken, and we'll accept that. But we're talking about concrete. I'm wondering, is concrete the only method that we'll look at for the local improvement? Given that we, switched out of concrete on Waverly Underpass and went with asphalt, and we're told there's no difference except for cost, would we not consider asphalt, and would it be more economical in the future?
Yeah, to answer your question, Councillor, this is an asphalt back lane. There are two options. There's that currently the city has. Public Works might be better to answer this question than I would, but there's two types of back lanes, asphalt and concrete. So this is part, this local improvement was proposed as part of the council initiated project to fund 50% of that for an asphalt top. So this would have been an asphalt back lane if it was successful.
Okay, could it just make sense then? Thank you. Okay, we can call for the vote.
Yep.
Do you want to move your vote?
So moved. I don't know if Councillor
Lewis had a question.
I'm voting.
Yeah. Oh, I think the clerk needs an actual motion.
So just to clarify, Councillor Gillingham's motion is to concur in the recommendation of the public service, and then this would be a recommendation that goes to Executive Policy Committee and then Council.
Yes.
Exactly what he was going to say.
Exactly. Took the words out of my mouth.
Meatloaf, great song. Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you very much. Okay, we will move on now to item three, the honorary street naming, and we'll turn that over to Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The report before you is proposing to rename, or not rename, but to provide to Fiddler Avenue a designation of honorary Herb Channon Way. Mr. Channon is a remarkable individual that has lived in his home, has lived in the St. James area, Silver Heights, since 1953. He's 97 years old. He is sharp as a whip. He's a World War II veteran, and we don't have a lot of World War II veterans still living among us. He's been very involved in the community for, you know, his entire time since 1953, his entire time living in St. James. I had a chance to speak to Mr. Channon about a month and a half ago, just specifically about his time in World War II, and just to hear the remarkable stories of what he went through. He was a flight engineer on airplane called the Canso Bomber, and what they did is they were stationed out of Reykjavik, Iceland, and they would fly missions over the North Atlantic, searching for enemy submarines and ships to identify them, and really to try to make sure that the North Atlantic was as safe as could be, and involved in the Battle of the North Atlantic, so that Allied ships and merchant ships and supply ships could get in and out of there. So a lot of the men that he served with did not come home and died in the war. And so I think it's only right and fitting for several reasons, not the least of which Mr. Channon's service to our nation and to democracy and freedom. It's only right and fitting that we find a way to honor him and acknowledge him. I've spoken to his children. He's got five children. They live kind of from Ontario through to British Columbia, and they're certainly supportive of this. In fact, I kind of went through the children to surprise Mr. Channon, and I called him this week once it hit the agenda, with the agreement of his daughters and sons. Surprised him, and he was very, very moved that we would consider doing this to honor him as and to acknowledge his sacrifice for our nation. So, so the motion is before you. The report is before you with corresponding a letter of approval from his daughter on behalf of the family, his daughter Pamela. And so I would ask for my council colleagues' support in the honorary street naming to Herb Channon Way.
Any comments, Councillor Lukes?
No, that's really beautiful. That's, you know, you've got a lot of long-term residents in St. James that have amazing histories, amazing people. And, this sounds beautiful.
Yeah, I think this is exactly what honorary street naming was designed for. Yeah. So let's call the vote. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried.
Thank you.
Okay, well, we'll move on to the next item. And Councillor Gillingham, if I could pass the chair over to you.
Certainly. Item number four, non-conforming approach, 14 Zimmerman Drive. And 23, 27, 31, 35, Alora Cove.
So this is an interesting application. As it came forward, the public service is not recommending it, and I have not spoken to any of the parties involved previously about this, which is, as you all know, often we will get involved when people are looking to make changes to talk to residents, and the public service is not recommending that this committee approve that. Having said that, I would like to, with my colleagues' support, lay this over until the January meeting to allow for time to have some discussion and get a better understanding of what is trying to be done here, and a better understanding of why this is not appropriate, so that we're just not making a decision, or I don't feel I'm just making a decision based on information in front of me. I just want to dig into it a little deeper. So I would like to move that this be...
Can I make a comment?
Yeah.
So I have a lot of this situation that happens in the Waverly West ward, Councillor Klein. Some of them you've actually voted against supporting for a non-conforming approach, actually exactly similar to this. Often it's families that purchase the lots together. Anyways, I'll just remind you that, you know, I too have a lot of these requests, and that you too have denied them. So I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, I haven't really denied a lot of your.
Oh, but you did do the one. You did do the one. And
it was, I did do one?
And it was almost identical to this. So just reminding you. I'm curious to hear what your logic will be when you come forward.
I learned a long time ago not to argue about that with you. I accept that. Right now, I've given my logic. So I would like to move that we lay this over until the January meeting of the Assiniboia Community Committee.
Okay, it is moved, layover. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you. I will turn the chair back to Councillor Klein.
Thank you. Item number five. Interesting. It's the establishment of a planning commission. So I don't think we have anybody here.
Oh, we do. They're joining us via Zoom. We have David Jopling, Mark Pate, and Mike Lennon from the Public Service.
Excellent. Good morning, gentlemen.
Morning, councillors. So what we have today is, it depends on what you'd like us to provide, but Mike Lennon is here. He can provide an overview on the background research report that accompanies the item, if committee would like to hear from him. I'm here today to answer or speak to any questions related to proposed timelines that are included in Bill 37, which used to be Bill 48. So however the committee wants to proceed, it'd be great if you could let us know.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Pate. This would be the, dates back to the original Planning Commission motion that I put forward, I think it was 2019, right?
It does, and each community committee has considered the item, but the Standing Policy Committee provided a 180-day extension, asking that each community committee consider the report and put forward its recommendations back to Standing Committee.
All right, well, I'm going to turn to my colleagues for their opinion. How would you like to proceed? Would you like an explanation of the report, first of all, and then we can ask questions and then speak to Mr. Pate about how the impact of the new bill may affect this or assist, support this?
I'm good with that that process, yeah.
Councillor Lukes?
So just repeat the process again.
We would have an explanation of the an yeah. overview, if you will, of the presentation, and then we'd we can ask questions then, and then we could speak to Mr. Pate of how this might of how the bill, the looming bill, may support or affect this this particular motion.
Yep, sounds great.
That work for you, sir, Mr. Pate? Yep,
certainly. We'll let Mike take the floor.
Thank you.
Good morning, councillors. I'm just, my video is not working right now. I think to the clerk, would you be able to turn it on? So I think it's been turned off.
We've asked you to start video, so you should be able to just press.
Yeah, okay, now it's back on. Okay, so what I'm going to present is an overview of this report. Some of the context and discussion since the release of this report, and then some possible next steps for your consideration. So this report, as you know, was prepared as directed by a motion from the Standing Policy Committee on Property, Heritage and Downtown Development in September 2019, moved by Councillor Klein. The report reviews the concept of a planning commission, a brief history of planning commissions in Winnipeg, the applicable sections of the City of Winnipeg Charter, a scan of planning commissions in Canadian and U.S. cities, along with some lessons learned, and an analysis of some of the opportunities and challenges that a planning commission would present for the City of Winnipeg. So the concept of a planning commission is a group of people appointed by a municipality to provide advice, research, recommendations, and or decisions on planning matters to municipal council. Canadian planning commissions are generally appointed with local experts from within the geographic area over which the commission applies. Planning commissions tend to take an advisory role or a decision-making role on development applications. Winnipeg has had several planning commissions. This wouldn't be the first one. Between 1914 and 1960, there were several of them, and then it was stopped when the quasi quasi government that oversaw the Winnipeg region came into place for between 1960 and 1970. All of them were advisory in nature. And the Winnipeg Charter in its current form allows for the creation of a planning commission that would have a, both an advisory role and a decision-making role. So what the charter allows is a commission in Winnipeg would have the ability to hold hearings and make decisions on conditional uses and variance applications. So this is currently the role of community committees and was the role of Board of Adjustment. The Planning Commission could also have the role of holding public hearings and making recommendations on now Winnipeg amendments, secondary plans, zoning bylaws, subdivisions, development agreement amendments, and business licenses. The Charter also allows a commission to report and make recommendations in respect to any planning or development matter referred to by council. So this could be pretty broad. Council can refer any planning matter and they could conduct research, prepare reports, make recommendations to council, etc. I prepared a thorough review and comparison with interviews of I did a thorough review of seven Canadian cities and three US cities. And six of these cities, I had interviews with the Planning Commission liaisons. This section provides an overview of terms of reference and practices in other planning commissions. I should mention that terms within the planning commissions and all of them overlap the terms of members so as to provide continuation of the knowledge held by the planning commissions. Typically, a planning commission has 5 to 10 members, generally appointed by council. Large cities tend to identify specific areas of expertise sought for these positions in the bylaw. So a large city will often have a position within the planning commission for various roles, such as a planner, an architect, somebody in real estate law, civil engineering. Large cities often have a counselor, a mayor, and or a city staffer on the commission. And the clerk's office manages the recruitment and members are appointed by council, typically. The chair is often, but not always, selected by existing members, and some require that the chair is a counselor. Meetings tend to be once or twice per month, usually. Some of the opportunities that a planning commission could present to the city. Councillors currently, in their role as a decision maker on the hearings, cannot take a position on development applications prior to the decision. And so one opportunity is that this could free up time for councillors to take positions on issues prior to the application being heard. A commission could also free up councillor time to work on other matters, not overseeing hearings. A commission could provide consistency of decision-making. So for instance, you'll sometimes have a similar application at one side of the city and another side of the city and have very different decisions made because there's a different set of councillors. You have the continuation of knowledge and you have experts on this panel. So you do not risk having, when you might have one or more counselors who are new at the same time, you might have a bit of a learning curve, and a planning commission reduces the risk of having that learning curve. Decision-making accountability. Members of professional associations such as planners, architects, engineers must abide by the rules of their professional association if they're a designated member of the association. For instance, professional conduct. Generally, these associations have ethical guidelines. Further, Brandon requires that new members, or that members of Planning Commission follow the Municipal Council Conflict of Interest Act. This only applies to councillors, but a bylaw for this commission could require that these members follow this as though they are in the role of councillors as well. I should also mention that Omaha has a detailed set of policies in addition to the bylaw that commission members must follow. And this is more detailed about conflicts of interest and various issues to ensure that there is a standard of conduct. Some of the challenges with the Planning Commission would be the lack of local representation that we currently have with the community committees. The community committees have councillors who know the characteristics of the area and often have an in-depth knowledge, but there are no planning commissions that I have seen in my research that have commissioners represent anything other than the municipality or the area over which the Planning Commission sees. The work volume at hearings could also be high. As you know, sometimes community committee hearings can last quite a few hours. And so when you have five of them combined, it could be a challenge to manage this workload and have the potential of commissioner burnout. Brandon has addressed this by reducing applications through having annual zoning bylaw updates. Lethbridge and Regina give development officers authority to approve minor development applications. Another issue is a planning commission could not just simply be inserted into the city. It would lead to, or it would have to be implemented with some restructuring of the decision-making structure and councillor duties. For instance, the community committees might see significant changes if a planning commission is to come into place. I should also mention that previous changes to council's structure over the decades have been led by high-profile commissions led by experts in the field. For instance, the Task Force of the Restructuring of Council in 1995, Task Force of Community Committees in 1971, and various other task forces over the years. So just to recap, this report does not provide an in-depth review of the changes needed to existing procedures or of committees of council. Given the implications that such a high-profile change would have, a broader and more in-depth review of these changes should be conducted in order to support an informed decision. And previous changes, as I just mentioned, to this magnitude have been led by high-profile commissions with local experts in the field. So I'm just going to go now over some of the key themes at the community committee discussions. Last May, as you know, the Standing Policy Committee had sent this to the community committees for initial discussion. Some of the councillors, consistently, councillors had expressed concern over the timing of Bill 37, formerly Bill 48 with the province, and a lot of uncertainty about what this would mean. Many councillors felt that this topic warrants further information and discussion. Some councillors expressed that councillors have local knowledge, for instance, character, neighborhood character, and issues going on within the neighborhoods that might help inform local decisions. Commission members being experts in the field may have close ties to the field, it was brought up, and there is the potential of conflict of interest. One comment was brought up. And Planning Commission would allow councillors to have the ability to stand in support or oppose to a development, as I mentioned, to take a position prior to a public hearing on issues. As you mentioned, there is Bill 37 that is currently underway by the province and hasn't been enacted into legislation yet. Also, our Winnipeg and Complete Communities are still underway, and the governance review is still underway, and we're not sure yet at what point that will be completed. So I prepared a few questions just for your consideration. There may be more questions that I missed out, but these are just some starter points. Is there a model of a planning commission that you would prefer? Is there something that the city should explore further in order for you to make an informed decision? Where do you believe a planning commission could have its greatest value? And with Bill 37 prescribing timelines to approve development applications, the city will need to look at improving its development approval model. And do you see a planning commission fitting into this model? And if so, how so? Further, I just prepared a few points. You can make a recommendation today. And I have a few possible recommendations. There might be more that you may consider. But one option is that the public service be directed to prepare a planning commission model for council's consideration. Another, that the public service do further research to provide information on the following topics, which you can identify right now. That the City of Winnipeg delay the decision until a later time. That the City of Winnipeg submit this report to the government's review to report back and make recommendations. Or finally, that the City of Winnipeg not proceed further with the Planning Commission at this time. And again, there might be more options out there, and these are some I prepared as a starting point. And so I'll let you ask any questions.
Thank you very much. It was very detailed, and I certainly appreciate how many jurisdictions you spoke to and the information you provided. So excellent. Thank you very much. And I read through the work previously, and I thought it was well done and well researched. We have some questions, and I'm sure we'll have more as we go along, but Councillor Lukes had her hand up first. So Councillor Lukes, why don't you begin for us? You're muted. Oh, Councillor Lukes.
Okay. Yeah, there you go. So, yes, thank you very much. This is a good comprehensive scan to provide us some insight. But I guess there's two things that I want to bring up. I want to hear what Mark Pate has to say about Bill 37, where we're at with that. So I think that's going to play into it. And to the committee members, I also want to talk about the governance review and how that also will play into all of this. I think the timing's good in a way that we have all of this going on, or potentially going on. But I kind of feel a lot of this is, you know, Bill 37 being a child of the parent, so to speak, of the province. I think we have to see how Bill 37 unfolds. I could be wrong, so I'm waiting with bated breath for Mr. Pate's presentation.
I didn't really prepare a presentation, but I can speak to Bill 37 and in its current form. The recommendation when it came to timelines didn't change when Bill 48 became Bill 37. And the Assiniboia Community Committee identified this as a concern early on in the process. How this ties into the conversation with respect to the establishment of a planning commission is that the bill includes timelines for many development applications, many of which are heard by community committees. And the impact is that if a timeline is missed, and that's if, for example, for a subdivision rezoning, council conditional approval isn't obtained, the owner can consider the application to have been rejected and may appeal the rejection to the municipal board, who would hold an entire new hearing and make a decision on the matter. So why is there risk? The current approval hierarchy requires that many files need to go from community committee to standing committee to EPC and then to council. So this in and of itself provides for longer timelines for ultimate approval by council, or at least consideration by council. There's no provision in the bill for layovers. even if the applicant at a public hearing requests that committee lay over the public hearing to consult with area residents, for example, there's no provision in the bill for a layover. So what could happen is the applicant requests a couple of layovers, isn't able to find any concessions that would satisfy area residents, community committee votes in opposition or votes to reject an application. And before it actually gets to council, that 150-day timeline times out. So the applicant, knowing council will likely support the community committee's recommendation, would ultimately appeal, and this would go to the municipal board. So your recommendation as a community committee may factor into the municipal board's consideration, but ultimately it won't go to council for further adjudication. There's also no provision for when council prorogues, which, as you know, councillors, is very impactful in an election year, where council would typically take its summer prorogue and then prorogue for the month of October, wherein no hearings can be held during that time frame. So I've had a number of meetings with the province and raised these as concerns and asked that some allowances be built into the wording in those specific clauses. They've acknowledged our concerns, but have not amended the bill to provide for exceptions. These could come later in regulations that would accompany the bill ultimately, but in its current form, these are some of the risks that the bill would provide.
Yep. You're muted again.
Periodic dog barking. We have to eliminate that. Okay, so Mr. Pate, do we know when Bill 37 is coming forward?
So Bill 37 was given first reading about a month ago, and it's been on the order paper virtually ever since. So for second reading. So at the province, what would happen with a bill like this is once it's provided with second reading, it would get referred to committee. And committee would be required to hold a public hearing on the bill, at which I plan on presenting on behalf of the City of Winnipeg Public Service with our concerns. And I guess the risk is, and I monitor the provincial website every day, is that they could schedule the committee hearing within 48 hours of second reading. So I don't anticipate the province would try to slide this one through without our participating in the process at committee, but there's always that risk. So I continue to monitor daily their website.
Okay, and what has changed from the last council briefing that we had on this?
In terms of Bill 37 from 48?
Yeah.
They included a couple of new clauses that we're a little bit concerned with. We've had a meeting scheduled with them that's been rescheduled twice. I get to meet with the province next week to discuss the implications of, in particular, Section 235.1, which has to do with secondary plans that I won't necessarily get into right now, just because I need some clarification from the province, because the wording is pretty ambiguous. They did tighten up some of the language and actually listen to some of our concerns and some of the flaws that we pointed out in the legislation have been fixed. They've tightened up some of the appeal timelines, reduced them from 90 days to 30 days. They've actually provided timelines for municipal board adjudication on appeals. So before they didn't have those timelines, now it does. They have to make a decision within 120 days of an appeal being filed. So there have been some improvements with the bill.
So will there be an opportunity, I guess, even let's say after you present to the province or discuss with the province, not present, but after you discuss with the province next week, is there another opportunity to have a council update on this? I mean, I guess there is. You're not the right person to ask. I know that's been beaten into me. But I would personally, if you're going down speaking on behalf of the city when the public hearing comes, I'd like to hear what you're speaking about.
Yeah, and I think I qualified that. I'm speaking on behalf of the public service at the committee hearing. So not necessarily politically on behalf of the city.
Okay. Yeah. And I know the mayor has said publicly that he's attending as well, but we have to stick to the motion, I guess, for this one. But I agree with you, Councillor Lukes. We need to, it'd be nice to be informed on this. Councillor Gillingham had a couple of questions. Can we move to him and come back to you, Councillor Lukes? Ms. Gillingham?
Thank you. Thank you both for your work on this. The history and some of the presentation here. A couple of questions, I guess, maybe Michael, for you first. In the report, page 9, there's the table lists 7 different planning commissions. Have I got this correct that 4 out of the 7 conduct hearings? Public hearings?
There are several that conduct public hearings and make recommendations. I think Regina and I'm just going to, that was table 2 or table 3?
Yeah, it's table 3. I see okay. Primary function, I see conduct review and hearing, conduct hearing. I think Calgary, if I read this right, Calgary, Brandon, Lethbridge, Minneapolis have a hearing which they conduct here, their hearing body as well, public hearing body. Am I reading the table right?
Yes, they conduct hearings. However, Lethbridge and Calgary don't make their decision. They make a recommendation. So they conduct a public hearing and make a recommendation. Minneapolis and Brandon conduct a public hearing and make a decision at that time based on the public hearing.
In those jurisdictions, I guess in specifically that where a planning commission conducts a hearing and either makes a decision or makes a recommendation, what is the appeal body structure for either the applicant or the residents? What is the appeal body? Is it an elected body like the council of that community, or is it a municipal body, or just what's the appeal mechanism in those jurisdictions?
I'd have to look at this again, but I had seen consistently there were appeal bodies, and from my understanding they were, you know, and I might have to review and take a look again at this, but the appeal bodies I had seen were all councillors, made up of councillors.
Because certainly, yeah, that's obviously, that's where you can see where my question's going, and maybe Mr. Patey can speak to that. I'm just trying to understand, you know, obviously there's different models in different jurisdictions, but if there are commissions that conduct hearings and make decisions or conduct hearings and make recommendations, I'm curious as to whether the appeal body that is maybe the subsequent step in the process, given the decision and recommendation, I'm wondering if the appeal body is something akin to what is being proposed in Bill 37, that is an appointed municipal body, or whether it's a appointed municipal board, or whether it's a board made up of councillors of the municipality, or just what that appeal body is.
Within Brandon, I mean, the planning commissions are all subordinate to council. And so when a city creates the appeal mechanism, when it has one already, it's not an appeal body that's above council, like the municipal board. So it's, I guess what I'm saying is it's under the city's jurisdiction to create the appeal body through bylaw rather than have to appeal it to the municipal board, which is governed by the province.
So thank you. So if I'm understanding you right, then in these instances and these, all 7 of these commissions, the appeal body within those jurisdictions is a municipally appointed appeal body. It is not a provincial appointed body.
Exactly. There's only 2 that actually make decisions. That's Minneapolis and Brandon. Okay. Brandon has, I mean, there's some similarities in legislation. I mean, I'd have to refresh and take a look at this, but Brandon, I imagine, would be, it's actually Brandon has the most similar planning commission that Winnipeg can potentially have of all the planning commissions I've looked at.
So how, just out of curiosity then, sorry to jump in, but how is Brandon's Planning Commission and the decisions, I'll back up. So Brandon's Planning Commission, if they right now make decisions, not merely recommendations, but if they are the decision-making body, any appeals from of that, the decisions made by that body, they go where? To the municipal board? Or do they go to a Brandon City Council entity, whether it's an appointed board or a council board?
You know, to fully answer this question, I will have to take another look at this. And I can provide, I would have to get back to you on this.
Okay, thank you. No, that's fair. I guess my only other comment or question, maybe it's, is I think something that both of you raised and Councillor Luke's raised as well. At the same time, we've got a lot of kind of balls in the air right now with the idea of, you know, looking at a planning commission, Bill 37, the governance review, our Winnipeg, and no doubt those all need to dovetail, you know, so that whatever is done would ultimately be effective. I guess, Mr. Pate, is your thought, would you lean towards that it is important council understand ultimately what legislation or what is enacted around Bill 37 and what the final form of that legislation is before council can really make any other decisions? Like, I mean, if we were to make a decision today to say, let's do X, and then Bill 37 comes in, and it could completely upset the apple cart of what decision council would make prior to whatever the final bill looks like, correct?
Yeah, it could. And I think it's important that, and I remember back in the early 2000s when I was with City Clerk's Department, there was a conversation about the move to a planning commission when the City of Winnipeg Charter replaced the City of Winnipeg Act. And that was the first time that our act included a provision for a planning commission. At the time, council wasn't supportive on the whole of the move to a planning commission. So I think it's an important conversation for council to have, if the basic premise of a planning commission replacing some of the functions of community committee is something that council wants to consider. And further to your conversation about a planning commission proper, what a planning commission may or may not do is actually outlined in section 273 of the charter.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, so I'll have probably more questions later on, but for now, those are my questions. Thank you.
Thanks. A couple, I appreciate the work by both gentlemen again. The concept and the idea behind the motion of the planning commission was for various reasons. One of them, of course, being that decisions are being left to members of council that may not have the necessary skills or knowledge or training or education to make decisions based on certain development practices or planning practices. The fact that when you look at Lethbridge and Calgary, that these are being used to provide recommendations to council in addition to what the public service is providing, that I believe will help with that. My question is that no matter what happens with the Bill 37, if it's implemented in Winnipeg, it'll be implemented across the province. So that same issue will impact Brandon, as I understand it, that as will Winnipeg. And once it's made, it's made. And it could change. Maybe after Mr. Pate's presentation, they'll see the light of day and they'll say, yeah, Mark's absolutely right. We should have talked to him or whatever. Or they may not. But for us, the whole concept behind the Planning Commission and talking to others in our property and planning department, it does provide a level of expertise by individuals that you know, have skills in this area and that are obligated to be fair and reasonable and unbiased according to the associations that they belong to. It's part of their credentials. It's part of their commitment to their trade. So when I hear what you're talking about, I'm more pushed back to looking at saying, look, I understand that we have the power. We know that what's going on in our wards, and we like that. I think the understanding the character of our neighborhoods is really important, and hearing from the public is really important. And I think that there's a way to add that. And I think you've heard that from other councillors. So asking you now for your professional opinions, both of you, knowing that Bill 37 is going to come no matter what we do, in some form or another, it's going to come and things can change. Are we better prepared to keep moving forward today and say to your department or to the two of you, why not prepare the model that is best for a planning commission, for council, and working in collaboration with the department that would take into consideration some of the concerns you've heard from councillors through this process, and then, you know, provide that to council for another review. There's no rush to getting this done. We've waited this long, and that's good because we're trying to get it right. Because I think delaying the decision will just take us back to that point anyways. Doing more research, I think, would take us back to this point anyways. Not proceeding, I think, would be is a mistake. And I guess I'm looking for your opinion. Do you feel that that would be a good process to take at this stage of the game?
It's a pretty loaded question.
It was meant to be.
and again, so back in the early 2000s, the will of council wasn't there. Like, a majority of council didn't support a planning commission model. So doing the work in advance of actually knowing whether or not council on the whole, or at least a majority of council, would support the move to a planning commission, we may be doing work unnecessarily. And I do understand that there's a lot of support on council for a planning commission. So very, very difficult question to answer. Because, like, when you look at the approval hierarchy at the city, timelines could simply be addressed by community committees remaining the hearing body and making a recommendation directly to council, as opposed to through standing committee through EPC. That would, from a timeline perspective, that would be a simple solution to that problem. So, I'm sorry if I'm not answering your question completely, Councillor. It is a difficult one. I don't like tasking staff with undergoing work if it's not something that will be required in the end. So it would be really good if we got a clear indication from council that this is something that we need to do.
I appreciate that response, and I commend you for that. Let's not do the work if you don't think the support's there. And it was my original motion, so betting money would say it probably wouldn't get support at council. But I appreciate your comments. Thoughts of the others, if you want to jump in, you don't have to be as precise. I didn't finish answering, and then we'll go to Councillor Gillingham and then Councillor Lukes. Did you gentlemen have anything you wanted to add to that last question, or are you good?
Good morning, councillors. It's David Joplin. I thought maybe I'd touch on the item a bit. I think the intent of this discussion was to get a sense where councillors individually feel on the item, and just the point that Councillor Gillingham has raised regarding the appeal process is important, and that we would need to consider a lot of that information in the context of some form of model. In terms of moving forward, there are a lot of moving parts, but I think also Councillor Lukes indicated this might be a good time to look at this process right now because of all the moving parts that are happening. So, I think further discussion is needed, and we also need to have probably a model that sorted out that we could start identifying some pros and cons to. So I'll leave it at that for now.
All right. Thank you. Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you very much again. Maybe, I'm not sure, any one of you gentlemen, if you can help me just interpret the current legislation. Mr. Pate, you indicated Section 274.1 kind of outlines what a commission would do and responsibilities. And when I take and read that and I compare it to Table 3 and the various duties of across various jurisdictions, it seems that in Winnipeg, a planning commission, it says must, not may, but must. The planning commission must consider make decisions respecting applications, must consider make decisions respecting applications for variances and then for conditional use of land referred to the commission. And then it says report and make recommendations to council in respect of any planning or development matter referred to the commission by council. Can you help us just in three sentences understand what the charter is saying there? Is this body, must it be a decision-making body on hearings, or is it a body that makes recommendations to council? It seems to say both A, B, and C seem to almost conflict.
My understanding is that any application that is brought to the commission, it must make a decision on conditional uses and variances. I'll have to read that again for the rest of them. But my understanding is that it is supposed to, and I don't remember if it says must for the others, make recommendations on the other applications I mentioned.
The nuance there, councillor, is in the wording. A planning commission, if a variance is referred to it in accordance with section 247, it must make the decision. It's not saying that a planning commission must hear all variances and approvals, only if council delegates the authority to that body to hear them. I think that's where there's some confusion in that wording.
Okay, thank you, I appreciate it. I'll just make my comments are, I'm certainly open to, you know, a planning commission. I can certainly see the value of it. But I think that as members of the public service have said today, my view at this point is there's certainly more work to do, more analysis to be done. Again, Mr. Joplin said maybe a model or models to be considered. I think what's important too is that we do have some of these other reviews that are kind of live right now, and the ultimate outcome of those reviews really would have an impact as to what, if any, planning commission would be established and what it may look like. I think we need to know where Bill 37 lands when it's finalized. I think we need to know what the governance review says. I mean, there may be, if all of this comes together, there may be little value in any, or a little work of any for community committees in the future. So I think that's a reality we have to, you know, we have to look at. So there is, I think, a lot that is happening. To Councillor Luke's point, there's a lot that is happening in reviews of different Bill 37, Planning Commission, Governance Review, R Winnipeg. That's all happening in real time. So I think to proceed and land on saying we will establish a planning commission and this will be the model, I think at this point would be premature, though I don't think we should stop. I don't think we should just put this aside and do nothing. But I think that there's some other things that need to fall into place first. I'm really curious specifically on Bill 37 and the governance review.
Okay, thank you very much, Council. I hope that there's no changes to the community committee. I think we have to make sure that we're reaching out to residents more and more, not less and less, but that's just my thoughts. Councillor Lukes, I'm sorry, you had your hand up a while ago. You have the floor.
Sure. So I don't really understand how we can really proceed if we don't really know what's coming out in Bill 37. I think that's a lot like there's, as you know, we can go and we can make presentations to government and everything, but ultimately whatever the decision is going to be the decision. And then we need to work around that decision. And if it means that we are able to put in a planning commission or not, but I don't personally want to make staff go ahead and do anything until we know what's happening with Bill 37, because that's something that will have direct implications, from my understanding, on a planning commission. So, you know, a lot of great work has been done, and we'll see what falls out. In my opinion, we'll see what falls out of Bill 37, and we'll see what, you know, and then with the governance review, I think that the Bill 37s may have implications related to the governance review. So I think there's a lot of moving parts. I think we should accept this as information and wait and see. I mean, not sit and wait and see, but obviously present, do whatever we want to do with the province. But ultimately, why would we have staff proceed on something where there's a lot, in my opinion, a lot of variables yet?
Yep. I agree with all the comments that you've just made as well. Any further questions? Okay, I think Councillor Gillingham has a motion he'd like to move on this based on what we talked about.
I appreciate that. Again, I want to express appreciation to members of our public service at this time. I think if I'm understanding, you know, kind of the will of the of our committee here, perhaps I don't know if the matter is to, I don't know if it's best to either lay the matter over as a motion until the results of Bill 37 and its enactment are known, and then to reconvene on this matter at that time. Would that be a motion that is in order?
I think the request from the standing committee will time out, Councillor. So I think that some recommendation needs to go back to the standing committee. But I don't want to do the clerk's job for her.
Sorry about that, Mr. Patay. Do we know what the recommendation was from the community committee yesterday? Because I understood that they did a similar motion.
Actually, if I'm not too sure, the minutes aren't posted yet. So if Mike, if you were at the meeting, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Yeah, I wrote it down. It was moved that they recommended that the standing policy committee to the standing policy that the creation of the planning commission be suspended until the new provincial legislation currently known as Bill 37 is resolved. I don't know if I have the exact words, but that was the gist of it.
And the Rial Community Committee the day before just recommended that it be received as information, Mike?
Yes.
Okay, I think we'll maybe echo the motion of yesterday's community committee. I'm not sure which community committee that was. Sorry, could you just repeat that? You wrote that down, Michael. Can you repeat what the motion was, please?
Yeah, they recommended to the Standing Policy Committee on Property Development and Heritage Downtown Development that the creation of a planning commission be suspended until the new provincial legislation, currently known as Bill 37, is resolved.
And that was EKT, Councillor.
Okay, I would like to that motion, but I'd like to add to it with, I'll float this motion and my council colleagues can look at it. So basically that wording, but that, and further prior to the creation of any planning commission, more analysis be conducted related to a recommended model planning commission. I just think there's more to be done. Some questions, I think, you know, Michael was just saying today, there's some things he would want to go back and look at related to what the appeal mechanism is, and not to get too far ahead, but I just don't want to assume that whatever Bill 37 is, we are going to then go forward with creating a planning commission. I think there's more to be done. So
The motion, Councillor Gillingham, just to clarify, you're recommending to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development that the creation of a planning commission be suspended until the new provincial legislation currently known as Bill 37, the Planning Amendment and City of Winnipeg Charter Amendment Act, is resolved. and that two, prior to the creation of any planning commission, more analysis be conducted related to a recommended planning condition model. Planning commission model, sorry.
Yep, yes. Okay.
So if I may, do we want those recommendations to be focused on Bill 37, on the new bill, or generic?
That's a good point. Maybe if we leave them generic now, they can focus on Bill 37 after when it comes back. It could also focus on whatever the governance review, spits out, you know, and ultimately is. So I think that still gives us enough leeway to consider all of those factors.
Councillor Lucas?
Just a point of clarification with Mr. Pate. So it's had first reading. Bill 37 has had first reading. It has to have three readings before it gets to royal assent. The timeline, like what you're saying, is because there's a public hearing, they only need to have 48 hours to call a public hearing, which seems incredible, but whatever. And it seems like they're keen on moving on this. So I guess, I mean, we really can't project a timeline. It's impossible, right? So can you project a timeline or?
My last conversation with the deputy minister, they still haven't figured out how to facilitate hearings like clerks did so quickly and adapted. I don't think they have a process for virtual hearings yet. Mm. So that is probably delaying, especially right now in Code Red. I'll ask. I'm meeting with them next week, and we'll hopefully get more information from them. They've been pretty cagey about timelines. I know that in the spring, the minister indicated that this legislation was a priority for her government.
Yes, yes, I remember that.
So I think it remains a priority. Mm-hmm. Just can't really comment on their timelines more than that.
Okay. Thank you. I'm okay with your motion, Councillor Gillingham.
Okay, let's all in favor?
Aye.
Sorry, councillors, just before, if you don't mind, just to clarify, Councillor Gillingham, the intent of the motion was that creation of the Planning Commission be suspended, or would you prefer not be implemented until?
That's interesting.
Whatever you're more comfortable with, just.
Sure, let's go with not. I don't want to, yeah, sure. Okay. Let's go not implemented until.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, let's try that again. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thanks, councillors.
Thank you, councillors.
Stay safe, keep healthy. We'll move on now to item number six. The floor is yours, Councillor Lucas.
Okay, item number six is redeployment of staff from recreational facilities to support park maintenance. So, you know, I think there's, I mean, Councillor Klein, where did Councillor Gillingham go? I have some questions for him, actually.
Just had to step away for a personal reason for a couple of seconds. We can wait a few moments if you'd like. Can take a 5-minute recess. Why don't we do that?
Yeah, because there's questions. He's an EPC member, and I would like to inquire with some questions related to things he probably could answer.
Are you okay with a 5-minute recess then?
Perfect.
Is that all right? Okay, yep. 5-minute recess. Okay, we are back at Assiniboia Community Committee meeting for November 25th. We are joined, of course, by Councillor Gillingham and Councillor Lukes. We are on item number six, a motion that was moved by Councillor Lukes. So Councillor Lukes, again, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you very much. This is about redeploying staff. So I recognize that I guess that this will go to the Executive Policy Committee. Is that correct, Madam Clerk?
Yes, this would be a recommendation to EPC.
And then what happens there? Like, does EPC decide if they want to redeploy staff, or how will that work? Do you have any insight on that, Councillor Gillingham?
I don't have insight on that. I wonder if the redeployment of staff, I think, and I'd have to, you know, get clarity on this, but I think it's under the purview right now, the existing authority of the CAO to manage the city staff in accordance with how he deems fit. I believe he has the authority right now as it stands to do what your resolution is requesting. So, I may be wrong, but I believe that is the case.
Okay, so I guess I have two questions here that I'd like to talk to committee members about. One will be the motion. We can talk about that. But another one, I guess, in the bigger picture is, so is it ultimately the CAO that decides how long we keep staff, how long we keep paying them, how long in like this very rare pandemic situation? Like at what point, you know, at what point and who decides? Is it ultimately all solely up to him or, you know, I would think some elected officials would have a say at some point. Anyone have any insight on that?
I can jump in on what I've been researching by reading the documentation, the documents that are available to us. Okay. The CAO reports to the mayor and executive policy committee. So at the discretion of the mayor or committee, they direct the CAO. So they have the ability, and then I got this from the clerk's office, the wording that's there. So they do, under the current rules of governance, have the ability to direct the CAO. So the CAO can make decisions as directed. The CAO also has certain abilities and powers as any chief executive officer in an organization to make decisions on staffing levels and maybe even more so under the Emergency Act. I think he still has some of those powers in place, but no, I don't believe we've extended that.
I think the Emergency Act is, yeah, that is ended.
Yeah.
But the
one issue that I think that is with this that is probably why no one, and I mean, the EPC can do all that, say and do all they want with this one, but in my experience, which is, you know, over 15 years dealing with collective bargaining agreements and various different unions, you can't simply move somebody from job classification to job classification without going through them first and getting their approval. And does it impact wages? Of course, it's never going to go down. The hourly wage won't go down, or wages and level of wage won't go down. It will remain consistent. But if it goes up, then you're stuck paying more. I'm not stuck, but you would have to adhere to that. But you also have to adhere to other conditions, employment conditions or requirements. So there's a lot to do with that. I think it's a wonderful idea because you should be able to repurpose and reallocate resources. And that's why I've always, and why I was pretty upset that we never really get to talk about as counselors, you know, when new contracts come up, we don't have that ability to get involved and say, let's do some house cleaning.
Well, EPC does. EPC does. When I was on EPC, the negotiator would come to the table and talk about it with EPC.
Oh.
Yeah.
And again, you know, it's public knowledge to that end, to that point, though, it's public knowledge as to when each respective collective bargaining agreement ends, right? So each counselor has the opportunity to speak to, frankly, speak right to the mayor about preferences. And then subsequent to that, each collective agreement is voted on, comes to council for ratification if it doesn't go to arbitration. So council does have an opportunity in a public forum to, you know, kind of articulate what priorities they have related to what should or shouldn't be, you know, included in the collective agreement or changed within collective agreement. So I think there is opportunity for that.
Yeah. And I have a all due respect for Councillor Gillingham and for the process. But I reached my tipping point of it's publicly available a long time ago. No organization can run in silos. And you know, this is the problem with Parliament and the legislation sometimes, or the legislature sometimes, is that you have three-party systems, you have all issues going on. Municipal government is not a party system. This place runs on a party system. Yes, we have the ability to send an email. It probably will not be answered by the mayor if we want to talk about contracts and such. But yes, of course, it's easy to say that, you know, oh, we can certainly put our information forward. We can do this, we can do that. But there is a two-tiered system that's available. So if we will not be given the opportunity to sit down with a negotiator and talk about how to clean a CBA up or to talk about items that are in the CBA. And again, not out of any disrespect for anyone, there's nobody that sits on that committee that has any experience dealing with a CBA. None. Zero, nada, zilch. And we're going into it listening to one side. We're not allowing the benefit, the pure benefit of a council that's not run on a party system where you can use the voices of every member, every elected official come together as one, because we've created a two-tier system. So, and that's not for this discussion, and I don't want to get heated about that or challenge anything that's being said. Yes?
Okay, so I'll continue on then with my motion here.
Yes, continue on with the motion. But again, I just want to, as per your motion, it would take you weeks, months to get to that point.
Okay, so let me ask you this then. Maybe we do an amendment to this, because in further discussions, because the city is not building skating rinks, that is a duty that the Parks Department does. The Parks Department builds skating rinks. So, you know, in my therefore be it resolved that the EPC be requested to direct the public service to, and maybe Madam Clerk, you can help me with this. You know, I still want to include to, maybe it's either redeploy staff from closed recreation facilities or realign parks people. Like, there's no reason, in my opinion, right now, that those people that could be making the skating rinks can't be dumping the garbage cans. And I've submitted what the garbage cans look like in our parks. So, and they're in the Parks Department. You know what I'm saying? I hear you exactly, Councillor Klein, on the whole labor union, all of that. I, you know, that's a whole topic. But maybe could we, Madam Clerk, work that in, that, like, in my opinion, you'd think they'd be doing it now, but they're not. So I don't know. You know, I'd like to have that worked in, that they maybe redeploy parks people also from closed activities to improving our parks with, you know, winter maintenance. You understand what I'm saying?
I think so. If I could clarify, Councillor, you'd like the Executive Policy Committee to direct the public service to either redeploy City of Winnipeg staff from recreation facilities closed due to COVID-19 or realign staff from the Parks Department previously assigned to duties which are no longer required due to COVID-19 in order to support parks maintenance in the winter months?
You're amazing. That's exactly what I said.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. So folks, do you get that? Like, councillors, do you understand that in the sense that, you know, I seem to be on this big skating rink issue. I've got a lot of issues with skating rinks, but seeing as they're not building any, and you see the pictures I've submitted, our parks are being used at a rate like we've never seen before in the winter. And the park staff have, usually they have, in the summer, they have more staff, but, you know, they're laid off. So, you know, I just really would like to see cleanliness in our parks in the winter months, and surely there's got to be a way to figure it out. And I'm kind of surprised they haven't yet, but I really don't know how the Parks Department functions.
Yep.
Just saying, you know, don't know.
I understand exactly what you're trying to say. And because apparently I didn't support one of your other motions, I would support this one, going to EPC for sure. But I will note that there's, you know, not being privy to each job classification in front of me right now, there would be different job classifications within parks.
I'm sure it's convoluted mess, and we'll probably never get the garbage cans emptied. But it's the thought that counts,
and it is something that I hear and get photos from residents all the time. Doggy receptacles are either overflowing or garbage receptacles and such. And my biggest disappointment with all this is that I didn't know the city of Winnipeg 2 or 3 years ago stopped adding garbage cans. We're growing to a city of 1 million, but we're limiting garbage.
Well, that's because we haven't done a parks budget increase in 10 years, which I've been trying to get, but roads seem to rule. So, you know, yeah.
Okay. Anyways, so I would support it going to EPC. I just think there's many other issues that will come up.
But. Sure. Well, I want to try, right?
Yeah. Yep. I'll support you with that.
Just one question. Council Lukes, through you, Mr. Chair. I just wonder if Council Lukes have you been able to speak to our CEO, Mr. Ruta, about this idea?
No.
Because I agree. I think the redeployment makes sense, given everything going on in Code Red here. And as you say, the amount that our parks are being used right now, really one of the only things people will have to do to get out of their homes is to use our pathways and our parkways and go for a walk or a parent pulling their child on a sleigh the other day, right, just to kind of get out and get some fresh air on a decent day, you know, and with our rec facilities and community centers, our pools, our arenas all closed down, we do need opportunity to kind of take a break from just being homebound. And so it makes sense that we can redeploy some of the staff that may not be doing other things at this point and put them into our parks to pick up garbage or make sure the pathways are cleared. I don't know whether or not EPC needs to direct the CEO to do that. I'm not opposed to that, but I do think, and we should get clarification on that because I'm not certain, but I do think that our CEO has the authority within his purview right now, excuse me, to make that determination of redeployment of staff to meet these needs. But I'll support this motion going to EPC. Between now and then, also be looking to see what get clarity on the CEO's current authority.
Yeah, this is kind of one of these pivoting things, right? Where our parks hopefully can pivot and accommodate it. Okay, so that's my motion. It's a modified motion.
I want to be on the record that I think pivot's one of the most overused words.
I know I'm using it because it is.
So I may not be able to support the motion if you keep pivot in there. So anyways, okay. Yeah. Okay, Madam Clerk, can you just read back the motion?
The executive, therefore be it resolved that the Executive Policy Committee be requested to direct the Winnipeg Public Service to either redeploy City of Winnipeg staff from recreation facilities closed due to COVID-19 or realign staff from the Parks Department previously assigned to duties which are no longer required due to COVID-19 in order to support parks maintenance in the winter months.
All right, I'll call the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. All right, so we have two motions for new business. So, Madam Clerk, I will give you the floor.
And I had a third one too at one point, but.
Oh.
Okay, we do need to circulate the motions to the councillors in writing. So if you wouldn't mind sending that to me, Councillor Lukes, and I'd be happy to distribute it to the committee.
Sure, I was hoping to discuss it with them, but I guess I could make it up. I can write one up, sure.
And if we could just get a motion to suspend the rules to consider those three items of new business.
Moved by Councillor Lukes. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried.
The first item is a CIG application in Councillor Gillingham's ward.
Thank you. And Mr. Chair, this application is from Horizon Children's Center. They have been in existence for since 1976, and thousands, probably, for sure, hundreds, probably thousands of children since 1976 have, yeah, it would be if you, hey, by the time you add it all up in that many years, have gone through the Horizons Children's Center and kind of got their start in early childhood development. And they do a great work in St. James, kind of in the heart of older part of St. James. And they're looking to upgrade, revamp their outdoor play and learn area. There's a big emphasis that they have on not just play, but on learning as well. And they've moved to a lot of outdoor classrooms. They've done a series of successive investments and transformations of their property. And so they have requested a $10,000 community incentive grant to assist in the development and the upgrade of their outdoor facility. So in the past, I have provided some, I have provided through the CIPG of St. James some funding for other projects. And so I'm glad to support this one as well. And it's such a project that when we invest in this, it's kind of a partnership. By investing in these assets, we don't need to invest solely in city assets. And so they're kind of, it's a shared use space. So it makes sense to me. They're doing some fundraising. The application is before everybody. You can see the fundraising efforts that they have undertaken, and you can see the other sources of funding they have for this project. So I would move concurrence with the public service recommendation to provide $10,000 to this project.
Any comments? Councilor Lukes?
That's good.
Okay, I just want to add that I think it's a great initiative, and acknowledge how important these community incentive grants are, as well as the per capita grants. They are one of the only sources, if not the only sources, for a lot of councillors to keep their feet on the ground within the communities they serve, and to make an impact on their constituents personally, and to help the constituents of the ward. And I think they're very valuable to residents and to councillors. So and I think this is a great use of those funds. So I'll call the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. Madam Clerk?
The next motion is with respect to a request to amend a development agreement. And I believe Greg Jasper is with us via Zoom.
Ah, Mr. Jasper. Mr. Jasper?
I can tell you in detail about it, but oh, there he is.
We just had to wake him up.
Well, you know, this meeting's been very interesting. Sorry. So, yeah, actually, I don't even have the motion before me. So it's an amendment to a development agreement where the applicant was required to install an AT path on their property, actually on the Bishop Grandin right away. And so this went back and forth with the application. It was first proposed by the public service to install a walkway that was removed by the community committee at the public hearing. It was put back on at SBC and PPND, and then was finally adopted as part of the servicing agreement. The applicant has come back and asked if he could delete the AT path. And we've gone through with the public service. We have no issues with that. I believe Councillor Lukes was involved in the decision making on the original application for the AT path. So that is our recommendation, is to delete the clause for an AT path.
So maybe I'll elaborate a little bit further on this. Thank you very much, Mr. Jasper. So councillor colleagues, if you wanted to see exactly what's going on here, it's a duplication. If you want to pull up Agassiz Drive and Glengarry, like if you wanted to pull that up on your computer, what's happening is a large development has gone in right beside the Bishop Grandin Greenway. So by having the developer put in another pathway, it's duplicating exactly what's right beside it on the Bishop Grandin Greenway. So in discussions with the developer, the Bishop Grandin Greenway, which is right there, their new development runs flush to the Bishop Grandin Greenway. It's a very large berm. To have a sidewalk basically in the lower part in the drainage ditch and have one right beside it a few feet higher is duplication. So I asked the developer if they would mind doing a landscaping so that his people in the apartments look out and they see a landscaped berm with a pathway on it instead. So, you know, I'm not one to not want sidewalks or pathways. You know that. I'm sure you know that by now. But this is a duplication, and the developer is more than willing to do landscaping on the greenway that his people look out at, which is much more beneficial for people living in the apartments, and there's no need to duplicate two sidewalks.
Yes, I have no problem with this change.
The only question I have is that you agreed at the start, right, Councillor Lukes, not to have the AT path? Mm-hmm. And then at the PP&D committee, it was put back on?
Councillor Gervasi put it back on, but I don't think she really, I wasn't on the PP&D committee at the time. I don't think she really understood that, like, 15 feet away, there was the Bishop Grandin Greenway, because it was never mentioned in any of the development details that she would have read. So
okay. Well, thank you. If there's no further comments or questions, I'll call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. Thank you, Mr. Jasper.
Thank you, Mr. Jasper.
Madam Clerk.
So I believe Councillor Lukes has circulated her motion to the committee via email.
Right, and I'd like to speak to it, and obviously it needs the polish that the clerk can do. But when I was sitting listening to the overview of the Planning Commission, and seeing how Bill 37 was, you know, really the pivoting point of what would fall out with the Planning Commission and really the governance review. You know, I've been speaking to the clerks about the governance review. I think you folks know I'm passionate about a governance review, but I really think that until Bill 37 falls out, until we have royal assent on Bill 37, I personally do not want the staff beavering away and working away at the governance review until we understand the implications of Bill 37 and how it will play into then our committee, Planning Commission committee. Do you know what I'm saying? There's a lot of variables here that are all in play, that are all important, that are all happening at once. But I really don't think in January we should be starting into the governance review until we hear what the verdict is on Bill 37, because it's going to impact our governance model in some way. So why would we start? I mean, we've waited for 26 years. What's another few months?
I can certainly support that. I think it's the right decision. We know that there may be others coming in the sense of, you know, utility rates. Will the, you know, the province could take on the responsibility through the utilities board, the increase, or you'd have to apply for an increase to water rates and such. So I think we're in a time of change at this particular point in time. So no, I see no problem with delaying the governance review until Bill 37 receives royal assent. But I think to Councillor Gillingham's addition with our previous motion with respect to the Planning Commission, that maybe what we want to do is say at such time we have to start considering what's been added or what's been implemented by that bill to be considered in the governance model, and making it generic enough that it can or cannot, that it can be, but making sure that it is at least worded so that we take into consideration Bill 37. So
this just is really, and I apologize, this has sort of come to me when I'm, you know, listening to Mr. Pate speaking and, you know, listening to the discussion regarding the Planning Commission. You know, maybe I'm not interpreting things right, but I really think there'll be fundamental changes coming out of Bill 37. And I really don't want to waste our money and our time and our staff resources doing something and then having to redo it. So what do you think, Councillor Gillingham?
Yeah, no, I agree. I think that provincial legislation kind of obviously sets the tone for everything because we operate as a creature of the province. So I would agree that it makes sense to put this on a pause until we see what the final legislation of Bill 37 is and how it may impact the city of Winnipeg and its structure. Good.
Do you want to?
So Madam Clerk, I don't know if you could maybe polish that up a little bit better, but I think you've heard the discussion, and you know, there's a lot of things, like we don't want to use our precious resources, staff and contractors or whoever we've hired, if we're going to have to redo it. And I think, you know, we've waited 20 some plus years, another few months, I think is a wise move and I have been a person passionate about the governance review. So I just think we're going to get a better end result if we delay it a bit.
Okay, Madam Clerk.
So, Councillor, if you're comfortable with the following wording, therefore be it resolved that the Executive Policy Committee be requested to delay the governance review until the new provincial legislation currently known as Bill 37, the Planning Amendment and City of Winnipeg Charter Amendment Act, receives royal assent.
Sure.
That's exactly what I said, yes. Okay.
All right, I'll call the vote then. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. Excellent. Madam Clerk and colleagues, I sent one that I think is important to talk about as well. Of course, it's for your consideration, so I'll pass the chair, Councillor Lutz, to you this time, if you don't mind.
Could we just get a motion to suspend the rules to hear an additional item of new business, please, councillors?
So moved by Councillor Luke. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, that's carried. Councillor Luke?
I'm here.
There she is.
Okay, so Councillor Klein has brought a new motion forward. Do you want to read it, Councillor Klein, and talk about it?
Sure. I think given the recent announcements and political announcements and such, I would like to move a motion that the search for a new CAO be stopped until the next mayor is elected in 2022. I'll give you my reasoning for that is because we sign long-term contracts or even five-year contracts that are pretty ironclad with individuals for this position. These positions are, you know, decided upon by
the authority of the mayor, and I know that they put together a hiring group, and again, as noted earlier, the CAO reports directly to the mayor or EPC. And this is an important position. I think it becomes even more important as we start to move out of COVID and into, you know, what will be the new normal, as we called it a long time ago. We're seeing the lasting effects or the effects of COVID has now lasted much longer than we thought they would. And I believe the next CAO that we hire for the city of Winnipeg, we have to make sure it's the right one. We have to make sure it's the person that is going to do the job and do the job that that council needs done, and so on. And I don't think that now, knowing that the mayor is not going to run for a third term, that this is the best decision. If an executive decides at a senior level to leave their position, that person would not. Normally, they could give a one-year notice. I've had that happen. I understand that. But that person would not have the ability to hire high-profile positions. That would move either up the ladder or would be held off in most cases until the next person, until that role was filled, because that's who the person would have to report to, and they have to be a part of that team. And I think it's in the best interest of all city councilors and in the city of Winnipeg to get that person, because if there is a conflict or there is some issue between whoever runs for mayor and who is elected as mayor with the CEO, and they don't have the same vision for the city or the same path or work ethics or desires, and there has to be an agreement to disagree, it costs the city hundreds of thousands of dollars in severance. I think we're better off right now to wait. It's not that long, less than 2 years. So that's my motion. As silence.
I'm waiting to hear from Council.
I'm waiting to hear from Council Luke.
No, I'm waiting to hear from you first. You're senior EPC.
Ouch.
On the heap.
Ouch. Shall I get your walker first?
Yeah. Yeah, so because this is, you know, just submitted to us now, you know, I'm kind of responding in real time without having the opportunity to give it further thought. There are two minds on this, I can see. The one that, you know, Councillor Klein has laid out. New mayor's elected. That individual, you know, a first order of business would be to select a new CAO to lead the public service, and obviously to work with the new mayor and new council. Can certainly see the rationale behind that. I can also see on the other side the rationale value of a new CAO being in place, so that a new mayor and their council and the councillors can really hit the ground running. That new CAO can already have begun to do some of the work within the public service and the leadership and the transformation of culture and efficiency, that work has already begun. And so the time and effort it would take to hire a new CAO would have been done and cared for. And as I said, the new council could really hit the ground running with implementing council and mayor priorities. So I can see that value as well. I think what we don't know in this case is the status of our present interim CAO. I don't know, you know, if Mr. Ruda is hoping that you know, a new CAO is put in place. I don't know if he's got post interim CAO plans that he's you know, kind of waiting to act on and exercise. I just don't know that, right? So I don't know if, you know, to say it candidly or just to say it plainly, if he wants to be in the role for what could be 3 years, two more years before an election, 9 months or so, a year, whatever the case may be, would take to go through the process of hiring a new CAO. So I don't think we know that either. And I don't know if we want to go with an interim. You know what I mean? Like if he says, you know, I'm moving on to something else. And then we're in the position of what, hiring another interim CAO. Again, just thinking this out in real time because the emotion is just, been kind of put in front of us at this time. So while Councillor Luke's talks, I will continue to think.
Okay. Well, I've thought an awful lot about this. I started thinking about this the day the mayor decided that he wasn't going to run anymore. So, and as you know, I've been really passionate about trying to get a CAO. I've questioned the mayor on the floor of council. I've spoken quite publicly about it. And exactly, there's two sides. There's absolutely two sides to this, you know. I've reached out into the community to many people who I hold with great respect on their opinions and ask them what they think, because this is a unique situation. You know, we add the layer of, you know, being in a COVID crisis to the whole mix. Yeah, this is really difficult. So, you know, I've always wanted a CAO and a mayor who would actually move towards some fundamental change in the way we do things within the city, to see improvements in the actual internal operations and how the actual machine of the city flows. And, you know, I don't think that if we hire a new CAO right now, that you know, fundamental change will not occur, because we're keeping our heads above water with COVID. We've got a lot going on. We've got to, you know, focus on paying the bills. We've got to focus on really, we have to focus on the money. So part of me leans to the fact that, well, you know what, Mr. Ruta, who's been the CFO for, I don't know, decades from what I can remember, but he's been here for a long time counting money, and he seems to know a lot about the financial situation. So he may be the good one to have in place as we go through this COVID time, where the focus really is on money and not really internal fundamental change. But then on the other hand, we're not going to find a CAO overnight. It's going to take a while. It's going to take a period of time to find a CAO who's going to want to come on board and basically rebuild the city, to help rebuild the city, because of the financial hits that we're taking on COVID, because of the pivoting, and the realignment and things that have been happening. So we're not going to find one right away. But, you know, on the other hand, I think if we continue looking for a CAO, and by the time I was involved in the selection of the first CAO, it's a very long, rigorous process. You have to interview many people. You know, this first process that the mayor had started a couple of years ago, it failed. So we're doing it again. It will take time to find the right CAO. So let's just assume it takes a year. So the new CAO starts and there's 1 year left before the election. So I could look at that as saying, well, you know, that 1 year gives him or her the ability to really... there's a lot to learn, right? There's a lot to learn. And I just hope we don't hire internal. I am just hoping we hire external. There's a lot to learn about the city. And if we proceed now looking for a CAO, in theory, probably that would give the new one a year to really kind of just see what the state of affairs is before a new mayor comes on and works with the existing CAO to do some really good fundamental change. So, you know, two sides to it. But I actually think I really would like to proceed with hiring a CAO.
You want to see the proceed hiring somebody? Okay, Councillor Gilliam, and then I'll share my thoughts.
Yeah.
On the other hand,
yeah,
I'm again wondering aloud, does the candidate pool for CEOs change depending on the outcome of the election? If candidate X is considering whether or not to throw her or his name into the ring to be the CEO, are they waiting to see who the mayor would be as to whether that's an individual whose priorities and whatever the platform is something that, you know, they more so whether they think they can and want to work with a mayor and council to implement kind of policies and through the administration. Does the candidate selection change? You know, do candidates go, well, I'm going to hold off to see who the next mayor is, to see whether or not I'm excited about the possibility of working with that individual and all the councillors that are elected. That may be a case. For that reason, I tend to lean towards support of Councillor Klein's motion.
I know it's very difficult. It's a very difficult position to be in. It's really regrettable that the first time around, the mayor didn't have his act together to get what he wanted written into the proposal. But we're moving forward, which is a positive sign. So, it's valid cases on both sides.
I agree. I want to make something clear because I don't want people making assumptions on this motion. This is not a reflection of Mayor Bowman. This is all based on its business. It's based on strategy, and it's based on many other conditions. If you take the time to look at it from 30,000 feet and you take the emotion out of it and you take everything out, you take ego out of it, all of that, and just look at the situation from 30,000 feet. A valid point by Councillor Gillingham that, you know, the pool could increase or decrease. It could go either way, but you may get more people applying. In a presidential race, you look at it, they come in with all their own staff. They've already got it set up and they go in, so they hit the ground running to use that. But you can never hit the ground running in any organization you go into, because you always have to get in there and see what's going on inside anyways. But you're going to want people with you that you trust. And it takes time to earn that trust and gain that trust. And that's why I don't put this on the mayor. But I'm looking, I immediately looked at it, and my immediate thought was, pardon me, is that, well, we should stop the hiring process. And I didn't say anything for a while because I wanted to take myself out of the picture and look at it from the 30,000 foot level. And I put myself back into that position where if I was changing a certain market leadership, what would we do? How would we take it about? And then looked at it again from a strategic standpoint that if you have changes you want to make and you know the next person that takes that chair will want to make changes. So I think that, you know, the conditions that one person is looking for, those are for a leader, the skills, experience, and so on that person has as the conditions they want a search firm to find in the next CAO may be different from what the next CEO / mayor for the city would have in mind to move the city forward. Doesn't make either one of them right or wrong. It's just people are different. So I'm looking at it truly from the 30,000 foot level and saying, let's do this right. Let's do this right, much like the governance model, like you just moved your motion for the governance model. Let's do this right. Let's remember, we have a deputy CAO now, right? So we have somebody in a position of attrition, if you will, right? So we've already got somebody set should something happen. I applaud that. I actually thought that was a very smart move because you always have to have somebody ready in case something happens. That's brilliant. That's how good organizations run. So we have that deputy CAO. Should Mr. Ruda say, I'm ready to move on to something else now, or I'm ready to enjoy my years somewhere else, because he's given a lot of time and effort to the city of Winnipeg. That's why I think this is the right time to put the brakes on that. Mayor Bowman has issues and items that he wants to work on for the next couple of years. He's been very public about that. Let him focus in on that. And at the next election, the next group of people or mayor that comes in, that will be their first order of business. Get the city on track and let's get the new CAO in, as opposed to trying to figure out if the two can work together. And then you're going through the process of releasing somebody. And then you've got now it prolongs the inevitable, if you will. And I think there's all kinds of issues that can come with that. Again, looking down from the 30,000 foot level and taking myself out of it and just looking at it from a very non-involved position. So that's all I can really say about it. And I wanted to be clear, it's not a reflection of anybody on the committee or anybody or the mayor. I think that this is the most important position that we are going to hire as councillors. And I think that that it should be done a certain way. So that's why I moved the motion. So, Councillor Lukes, you have the chair. You can call for the vote. You can continue to talk. You can ask questions.
Well, I just really feel it's going to take some time to get a CAO anyways. And I do think that council ultimately, to Councillor Gillingham's points all the time, does have the ability to say yay or nay to a CAO. We do have a staff of over 10,000 people that I think really needs CAO oversight. But so the motion's on the floor. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, motion carried.
Who's opposed?
Well, 2-1, so motion carried.
Thanks. There's both sides to this one. I mean, the motion has been, the questions and call, the decisions are made, but yeah, for sure, there's two sides to looking at this, the hiring of a CEO at this time. But
you know what I really like about this is there's two sides. These are the discussions that we should be having. These are good discussions. We should be talking about this as a group. And I'm glad that we had the discussion, and I appreciate that from my colleagues. So thank you very much. Any further new business? Councillor Gillingham moves to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, carried. Have a wonderful day. Keep safe. Thanks. Keep healthy.
Thank you.